Hi everyone, welcome back to Information Economics. Today we will introduce the moral hazard theory to you. So in this video I will give you an introduction, and then in the next video I will give you something that is the preliminary ideas you need to know, the KKT condition. And then we introduce three different models of moral hazard to show you what are the key factors of a moral hazard problem. Okay, so we all know that there are two types of private information, either hidden information or hidden action. And the more formal way to call them are the adverse selection problems and the moral hazard problem. So when you see a moral hazard problem, that means we are talking about hidden actions. Or when you are looking at an adverse selection problem, that means there are some hidden information inside. So we know what's the difference between information and action. Information is something that probably you know it, but you cannot change it. Okay, like how old are you is an information, but not an action. Action is something that you not just know it, but you also can control, somewhat control its value. For example, how hard you would like to study is an action. Okay, so why hidden action can create a problem? Let's consider the car insurance example. Consider a company and a driver. The driver has a hidden action, that is the after purchase driving behavior. So that means I first purchase insurance from an insurance company. And after that, I can decide how carefully I drive my car, okay? And that's an after-purchase driving behavior. And that is going to determine the probability of a car accident. So some key factors are here. I, as a driver, I can decide how to drive. That thing is hidden to the company. The company has no way to see how I drive my car, okay? The insurance company has no way to see that. And then, I as a driver, my behavior will affect something that the company cares. The company cares about the probability of a car accident, right? Because that is going to affect its profit. So, I privately determine something, but that's going to affect your profit. There is a problem between us. Once the driver gets an insurance, the interesting thing is that he is going to drive less carefully, right? If I have an insurance, then when there is a car accident, when my car is broken or get any trouble, the insurance company is going to handle that. So I have no reason to drive carefully. So if I get an insurance, I have no way to drive carefully, so I will drive less carefully. That is why companies typically ask for deductibles. Okay, that means, okay, if your car is broken and the total fee we need to get it fixed is $3,000, you need to pay for $1,000 as your responsibility. Something like that. Okay, so this typical example shows that there is a company, there is a driver. The driver determines something on the driving behavior that affects the company's payoff. And the company needs to design some mechanism so that the company can give the driver an incentive to do something that the insurance company wants. A similar situation occurs between a sales manager and a salesperson. The salesperson's sales effort, or how hard the salesperson promotes the product, determines the sales outcome, which is cared by the company or by the sales manager. Unfortunately, the sales effort is also hidden to the company or to the manager. So that unobservability drives the salesperson to work less diligently. Right? Because if the salesperson gets a fixed salary, no matter what's the sales outcome, the salesperson really has no reason to work hard. So that's why we typically see a commission or bonus associated with the payments to the salesperson. Okay? And the company needs to offer a commission or a sales bonus so that the salesperson will try to work hard. So again, that's an incentive mechanism. So in all the both examples, we can see that moral hazard indeed is an issue. And that issue comes from the fact that the agent can do something privately. The agent can do something that is not observable by the principal, and that affects the principal's profit, payoff, or whatever outcome. Okay, so that's something related to principals and agents. So that's why some people would like to call it the agency problem. This happens when the principal must delegate some actions to the agent. Okay, the sales manager delegates the sales responsibility to the salesperson. Okay, that's one typical example. Or if you want to go travel, in the past years, most traditional way is that you need to go for a travel agency and let the travel agent help you to find the airline ticket, to find the hotels at a foreign country. Okay, you have no way to do that, so that's why you allow the agent to do that for you. That's agency problem. And when we study agency problems, those theories that we have are called the agency theory. So some people would use agency theory, this term, to talk about the theory of moral hazard. Of course, some people would like to use agency problems and agency theories to denote all the problems related to information asymmetry. In general, the agent would take an action which affects the realization of an outcome that is cared by the principal. And that's the general situation. Just like the driver's driving behavior or the salesperson's sales effort, they all affect the realization of something the principal cares about. Okay, so that's the connection between them. The agent typically is the only guy that pays the cost of taking the action. But that particular thing is actually a key driver for the moral hazard problems. I as a seller, or I as a salesperson, if I want to work hard, in some sense I need to pay the cost for working hard. Okay? The company, the manager is still in the office and he does not need to do anything. It is me that puts a lot of efforts to promote the product. Okay, so the cost is, I need to pay the cost. The principal does not. So that's the typical case. So that's why the principal must somehow pay the agent to work hard, to pay the agent so that a desired outcome, a desired action can be induced. That's why the principal faces a contract design problem. The principal must decide how to design a contract or design a mechanism so that he can somehow connect the agent's action to the outcome. Okay? If the action is observable, the principal has one thing to do. The principal can compensate the agent directly according to the observed outcome observed actions. Okay? But if the action is unobservable, what the principal may do is to compensate the agent only based on the realized outcome. Okay? So for example, as a salesperson, his payment is determined by the sales outcome through the system of commission rate. Okay? That's how we connect an agent's payoff with the outcome. That's how we may induce the agent to do something we want. So in this video, I'm going to tell you that there are three important elements that will cause the moral hazard problem. Delegation or decentralization itself does not necessarily hurt efficiency or does not really create the moral hazard problem. The moral hazard problem is really a problem only if We have all the following three things. Only if the action is hidden, only if the outcome is random, and only if the agent is risk averse. The three things must be all together, be there, so that moral hazard is a problem. Okay, so today we not only want to introduce you to how to model a moral hazard problem, we also want to show you that how critical these three things are in creating a moral hazard problem. Okay, we will give you one model with deterministic outcome and two models with random outcomes. So the comparisons will also be gave to you. But before that, we need to talk about risk attitudes, because here, whether the agent is risk averse really will have an impact on the model, on the outcome. So let's first formally introduce how people may address or how people may model risk aversion through some mathematical terms. So let's first confirm our ideas about risk attitudes. Suppose that there are two random payments or random payoffs, A and B. When we say random, that means the realization may be different. But here, let's say, okay, A is a certain outcome. The probability of A being 1 is just 1. However, B is random. B may be 0 or 2, and the probability for each realization is 1/2. So you may treat A and B as two variables, random variables or random outcomes. So if you select B with probability 1/2, you're going to get $0. With probability 1/2, you're going to get $2, something like that. We can see that their expectations are the same. Okay, so it doesn't really matter whether you choose A or B, the expected value is the same. But the variance of A is less than the variance of B. In fact, variance of A is 0. Right, but variance of B is positive. So in many cases, people would say, okay, I prefer A to B. If I prefer A to B, I say I am said to be risk averse. I don't really like risk, so that's why I prefer a certain payment. Some people would actually prefer B, okay? Those people will be said to be risk-seeking. So they somehow like risk. They want to take the risk so that there is a probability for he or she to get a very high payment. Finally, if someone feels that the two options are indifferent, then we say those guys are risk-neutral. So that's the basic definition or the rough definition of risk attitudes. What we want to introduce to you is that one's risk attitude is governed by the shape of the utility function. So let's look at the example. Suppose I have two utility functions. One is that u1z equals z. This means z here. This is your payoff. Okay? The number, the amount of money you earn. And this z is your utility. Okay, so that means if I earn $100, I feel 100 points happy. If I earn $200, I feel 200 points happy. Something like that. On the other hand, U2 is different. U2 is that when Z is less than 1, my utility is linear to my payment. But after that, I don't care. All I want is some amount of money. After that, I don't really care about the amount of money. Okay? We're going to tell you that player 1 is risk neutral and the player 2 is risk averse. Why is that? If you put A and B into the outcome here, we're going to see that indeed, if you have the two choices A and B, and if your utility function is like this, then you are indifferent between A and B. Okay? You are indifferent between A and B. For A, you definitely get 1. For B, you either get 0 or 2. And the average would just be the same. But if your utility function is 2, then it's different, okay? For example, suppose I try to calculate my expected utility when my random outcome is A, okay? In that case, A is 1, so my expected value would just be 1. If I calculate my expected random payment of B, then with probability 1/2, I will have B equals 0, then I get 0. But with probability 1/2, B becomes 2, but I don't care about 2, all I can get is 1, according to this rule. Okay, so here I only get 1/2, if my utility function is U2. So A would seems to be better than B, because the expected utility from there is higher. So even though in practice it's hard to fully describe one's risk attitude, we adapt the following typical assumption. It's about the shape of our utility function and the risk attitudes. In the previous example, you already see that player 1, we say, is risk neutral, and U1 is a linear function. Player 2, we say, is risk averse, and U2 is actually something like this, right? U2 is a concave function, and we carry that example to the general case. When we say 1 is risk averse, we will set its utility function to be a concave function. When we say 1 is risk seeking, we set its utility function to be convex. When 1 is risk neutral, we set its utility function to be linear. So let's try to explain why we believe this is true in general. So consider a random payoff x and a concave utility function u. Okay, we're going to show you that this gives us a risk averse person. So if we draw a figure, it's going to be something like this. Okay, I have a concave utility. Okay, concave utility. So suppose I have two possible realizations of my random payoff. Okay, my random payoff may be either x1 or x2. Then if I try to calculate the expected profit, the expected profit would be here. Okay, this is the expectation of my two random outcomes. Suppose their probabilities are 1/2 and 1/2. Okay, so x bar is here. And that means if I am just offered this particular number of money, amount of money, with 100% probability, my utility will be here. Okay, my utility will be here. But unfortunately, my actual offer is a random payment, either x1 or x2. If I get x1, my utility is here. If I get x2, my utility gets higher, but the expected utility will be lower than what I can get with the certain payment. Okay? And you know this is not a special case. As long as your function is concave, as long as the curvature is downward, we always have the so-called Jensen's inequality. It says that if you have a random payment, and you first find the expectation, okay? First find the expectation, and then plug in that expectation to translate it to utility. That's going to be higher than you first find all the utilities, like here, and then take expectation. Okay? This is always true, as long as U is concave. Okay? This is because even if you get a high payoff, that only creates a not so high utility. Then there is a reason to prefer to reduce the risk and prefer a certain payment. On the other hand, if U is convex, then the result would just be different. Expected of UX would be greater than U of expected X. And that's because a high payment would really give us a very, very high utility if your curve is something like this, right? And finally, if U is linear, then you don't really care about whether it is this or that. The two quantities would be the same. the two quantities would be the same. So I hope that somehow explains to you why a concave utility function is useful when we want to model some guy who is risk averse. We're going to use that later in today's lecture. Thank you. Okay, so before we really introduce you the models, we need to first introduce the so-called the KKT condition to you. Okay, this is the main tool that we need to rely on when we solve those models. Okay, so let's do it. Let's first talk about something related to constraints and the so-called Lagrange relaxation. Suppose we have a constrained nonlinear program, in general like this. We want to study constrained nonlinear program because later you're going to see that when we formulate those moral hazard models, we are indeed dealing with constrained nonlinear programs. Okay, so what do we have? We want to maximize f of x subject to a few constraints, but we don't know whether they are linear or not, so in general they can be nonlinear. We're going to apply a so-called Lagrange relaxation method to these constraints. What we want to do is the following. So the idea is that, okay, I have a constrained program. I don't know how to deal with that, but I know something about unconstrained optimization. So why don't we try to somehow remove these constraints, right? If there's no constraint, then I know how to do it. But if we just relax or remove all the constraints, the problem would be too different, so we cannot do that. So the idea is that I want to have some Lagrange multipliers, and I multiply these multipliers to the constraints and move them to the objective function, like this. Okay, so for each constraint, I multiply lambda I to it, and then put the product to the objective function. Why is that? For this particular problem, we set lambda I to be non-positive. So please imagine that lambda I is negative, for example. If lambda I is negative, then if we want a very large objective value, we need gi of x given an x. We need that gi of x to be negative, right? So that negative negative gives us positive. If gi of x is negative, that means yes, indeed, we satisfy our constraint. So our hope is that we can remove all the constraints to get an unconstrained program. But we hope that hopefully x we found is feasible. And for that to happen, for the solver, for our optimality condition to give us a feasible x, we set lambda I to be negative, to be the penalty of violating constraints. Okay, that's the idea. So the relaxed program is much easier to solve. We define something called the Lagrangian, which is the objective function of the relaxed program. Okay, so this is the objective function of the previous relaxed program. We use this notation L of x given lambda to denote this problem or the objective function. The problem now is to maximize L of x given lambda over x when lambda is given. So you can see that for this particular problem, x is the variables and lambda is the parameter. Suppose x bar is the local maximizer of the Lagrangian, it's going to satisfy the first order condition. So because here x are vectors, so we use gradient, the concept of gradient, to denote the first order condition. Basically, it says that the objective function has its gradient, and that gradient should be zero. Okay? And you can take gradients inside. So the gradient of f plus the sum, the weighted sum of all the gradients of g should be zero when we plug in x bar. If it's too hard for you to understand all the details, imagine that you only have one variable and one constraint. Then this is just f prime of x. This is just g prime of x. Should be easier. But when you have multiple variables, it's just the same thing. So this is fine. This is fine. We know this. We know from here to here because we know the first order condition when there is no constraint. But very interestingly is that if x bar is a local maximizer to the original constraint program, then it must also satisfy the first order condition. It must also be a local maximizer to the relaxed unconstrained program. Okay? So I give you a constrained program, and I hope you can find a maximizer. You don't know how to do it, but you first relax the program to get a relaxed program with Lagrange multipliers. Okay? Then your x bar, if x bar is something you want for the constrained program, it must satisfy the first order condition for the Lagrangian. Okay? That's the key idea for this page. So formally, let's write it down. A very useful constrained optimality condition is the so-called KKT condition. And obviously, KKT is the initial of three scalars. Okay, so suppose I have a regular nonlinear program, blah blah blah, in this way. If x bar is a local max, then there exists some lambda. Now, you don't know the value of lambda, but you know there exists lambda, such that first, your x bar must be feasible, okay, obviously. And second, your x bar and the lambda must satisfy this thing. And if you compare this with the results you have in the previous page, you see this is exactly what we say as the first order condition of Lagrangian. Okay, the first order condition of the Lagrangian. And the lambda should be non-positive so that these multipliers are denoting some kind of penalties. Lastly, your lambda and g should satisfy the something technically we call complementary slackness. Is that your lambda times gi of x bar should be zero. Okay? And we don't have too much time to go through all the details. So please just know that, okay, there is something like this. Basically, we will mostly use the first order condition of the Lagrangian to solve the models we introduced to you. So this is the most important thing to memorize. Okay? And while you memorize that, you don't need to memorize each thing one by one. All you need to do is to memorize that this comes from the first order condition of the Lagrangian. Okay? It's easier to memorize the fact. A few notes. This condition is true only for regular nonlinear programs. Fortunately, most of the real problems, most of the practical problems are regular. So in this course, we will just ignore regularity and assume all the problems are regular. Second, this is only a necessary condition in general. So when I give you a nonlinear program, a solution is optimal means it satisfies these conditions. Okay? So these conditions can help us find candidate solutions, but it's not necessary, it's not sufficient in general. Finally, let me just emphasize again, the second part and the Lagrange relaxation, they have tight connection. And at least you can use the Lagrange relaxation idea to help you memorize the second part of the condition. Okay, let's do it with, let's show you how it is, how it works with one example. So, if I give you a constrained program, I will use the KKT condition to find candidate optimal solutions. If there is an optimal solution X star, then X star must satisfy all the three parts in the previous page. Then in particular, X bar must satisfy the second part. which can be useful enough. For example, suppose I have a problem of maximizing x1 squared plus x2 squared subject to 4 minus x1 minus x2 is less than or equal to 0. And before we really try to solve it, let's graphically solve it. So if I have x1 and x2, the constraint here says that x1 plus x2 must be greater than or equal to 4. Something like this. Okay, so the feasible region is here. And the objective function says that I want x1 and x2 to be as small as possible. Hopefully, they can both be 0 and 0, right? So you can draw a few isoprophic circles. And if you know that we are talking about circles, then obviously, your optimal solution would be here, which is 2, 2. Okay, so something we can intuitively do for this toy example. But now the main purpose is to show you that the KKT condition can prove that 2, 2 is really optimal. Okay, so first we want to find our Lagrangian. So we have our objective function, also objective function, and then you have your constraint. Okay, I need to first put all the things to the left hand side of a less than or equal to constraint, so that when I copy everything here, I know the lambda would be non-positive. If I want to put things at the left hand side of a greater than or equal to constraint, then lambda would become positive, okay? Because you are reversing everything, so the sign would be different. Or if you want, you may put everything to the right hand side. Then again, you decide whether lambda is non-negative or non-positive according to the same rule. Here, lambda is negative or non-positive. Once you have the Lagrangian, you do the first order condition. Here you have two variables, so you can do them once and twice. So for x1, you get 2x1 star minus lambda equals 0. For x2, you do the same thing, 2x2 star minus lambda equals 0. You don't really know what's the value of lambda, right? Well, given lambda, your Lagrangian is like this. But no matter what's your value of lambda, according to these two equalities, you know x1 must be equal to x2 for any value of lambda. This is because that when you have this constrained program, what you know is that if x star is optimal, then x star is optimal for this problem. Okay, then x star satisfies this and that for a given lambda. You don't know what's the value of lambda, but if that lambda exists, then x star satisfies this and that. And then that means your x1 and x2 must be identical. So that's why you can draw a line like this. Okay, the 45 degree line. All you need to do is to search for an optimal solution along this line. And then immediately you see 2, 2 is optimal. Okay, 2, 2 is optimal. Okay, so that's the KKT condition in general. We're going to have you some examples. So later when you have examples, pay attention to the process we do it. I give you a constraint program. Then you assume Lagrange multipliers. Put the constraints to the objective function, first order condition, and then do some observations to try to simplify things. And that's the idea. Thank you. Okay, so now let's present our first model, which is the deterministic outcome model. So in this example, we introduce the basic framework of moral hazard problems. So there will be an agent. The agent can choose an action or an effort level, which is A, and we say it is non-negative. Here, it may be easier to interpret action as some kind of effort. So if A is 0, the agent is actually doing nothing. Or if A is positive, that means the agent starts to work or to put some efforts. And then, effort is not free. So if the agent wants to work hard, the agent need to pay a cost for working hard. And the C function is the cost function of the agent. To make the derivation as easy as possible, let's say C of A is just A. To make the derivation easier, you are able to show that if C of A is something else, the basic principle, the basic ideas we can get will be the same. Okay, the action will determine the outcome. So the outcome is Q of A, which is the function of A in a deterministic way. So that means as long as we know what's the value of A, we know how much we can get as the outcome. Q is assumed to be strictly increasing and strictly concave, because when you put more and more efforts, the marginal benefit of those efforts would be decreasing. And then, the principal needs to somehow design a compensation plan to compensate the agent for the cost. So let's call the compensation plan as W. Okay? W can be in two formats. If the effort is observable, then W would be denoted as W of Q and A. That means I can pay you according to how much you work and what's the outcome. But if A is unobservable, in that case, the W would only be a function of Q, and that means I cannot see how hard you work. What I can do is to compensate you according to the outcome. For example, I don't know whether this salesperson works hard, so I pay him according to the sales outcome. The principal's payoff is Q of A minus W. This is the outcome generated by the salesperson's hard work or the agent's hard work, and that outcome translates to the principal's payoff. But the principal needs to pay something to the agent, okay? So it's money minus money. When we assume this format, we are saying that the principal is risk neutral, okay? Because all the monetary values transfers to the principal's payoff. For the agent, there may be two scenarios. If the agent is risk neutral, then again, he also only cares about money, the monetary values of his income and outcome. So the payoff would be W minus A. W is the salary, A is the cost. But if the agent is risk averse, then W becomes U of W. Okay, U of W. Your earning need to be put into the utility function. And then $1 does not always mean $1 when you are rich or poor, okay? U is strictly increasing and strictly concave, so that this shape can represent the fact that the agent is risk averse. Now, let's consider a few scenarios. First, let's consider the first best scenario with a risk neutral agent. The risk neutral agent's utility is W minus A, and the first best means that the action is observable. We want to first do this because later we're going to see whether that hidden action creates a problem. So the principal's problem is here. The principal can choose action level, okay? Because the effort is observable. So the principal can write that effort level into the contract. And then the principal can pay the agent according to the hard working and the outcome. So the function would be like this. The agent needs to get this to be non-negative. Okay, this is the agent's payoff, the payment minus the cost. And for this part, this is the benefit and this is the payment to the agent. So the principal wants to make sure that the agent wants to live in a stable system and maximize his own expected profit. Okay, to solve this problem, obviously the constraint must be binding, right? So the problem would reduce to just a single dimensional problem with effort level. The optimal effort can be directly solved as A star, And we know A star satisfies Q prime of A star equals 1. That's the first order condition of the objective function. And then our compensation plan. Okay, you have a lot of freedom. But anyway, all you need to do is to make sure that when the agent takes the efficient effort level, he also gets paid enough to cover his cost. Then he will be willing to stay. Right? So, all we need to do is to simply compensate the agent the cost of the efficient action. As the action is observable, I first choose the efficient action and then compensate the agent for the cost. Then the agent would be able to work and everything goes to my pocket. And the pie is largest, so I can really maximize my profit. This input-based compensation plan is so powerful. It does not need to contingent on the outcome. It only need to be contingent on the effort. Okay? So, it's fine. It's fine. Now, let's see whether we can still do it when we cannot control the effort level. In that case, the principal can only decide W, and W would just be a function of the outcome. Given W, the agent now solves a problem. The agent will choose an effort level by himself to maximize his own payoff. Okay, this is the amount of money he can earn, and this is the cost. Okay, notice that the agent is going to choose an effort level and knows how much will that effort level transfers to the outcome and how the outcome can be translated into his own payment. Okay? And let's use A to denote the equilibrium choice. Then the principal's issue is that A must result in a payment that is good enough for the agent to stay while maximizing the principal's expected profit. Okay? You can say that this is the IC constraint. This is the IR constraint. Okay? Quite similar to our screening scenarios. So now the question is, may the principal still induce the first best effort which satisfies a specific condition? Well, the answer is yes. Even though the principal cannot choose A star directly, there is a way to induce the effort, the agent to do that. Okay, I know what is A star. Okay, A star satisfies a certain condition. So I can calculate the Q star. Q star is the outcome under the efficient effort level. Okay, so I can expect that to happen. And then the mechanism is very simple. The principal can shoot the agent as long as the outcome is not Q star. Or more precisely, I can design an output-based compensation plan. In this way. So if I see the outcome is something I want, I pay you something that can cover your cost. If I don't see what I want, go die. Okay? So that's the output-based compensation that can induce the efficient effort level. Because once you are observing this, once you as an agent get this compensation plan, all you will do is to choose A star, and then the agent, the principal's problem is solved. So whether the action is hidden or not doesn't really matter. Okay, doesn't really matter. Okay, so you say, well, that was because the agent was risk neutral. So how about the risk averse agent? If the agent is risk averse, do we still have that? So let's do another analysis. We're going to say the agent's utility function is U of W minus A. Okay, so now the agent is risk averse. And let's still first consider the first best scenario. In this case, almost everything is the same, except that now we have this U function in the agent's utility function. U would only appear in the agent's side. Okay. For the principal don't really care about A. The principal only care about W, which is the amount of money that the principal pays to the agent. Okay, so you can see these two terms are different. And because of that, even though you know this constraint would be binding at any optimal solution, it's not going to be something that you can directly plug in back or blah blah whatever. But even though you may not be able to find a closed form solution for A star, you still know that, well, there is an optimal action level. Okay, then let's just call A star as an action level. Okay, that is preferred by the principal. Our objective here is to ask whether the hidden action will disallow the principal to implement the optimal action level. Okay, so that's just called A star as some optimal solution of this problem. Okay, A star is the optimal solution solving this problem. We don't know what's A star, but let's say it's A star. Then obviously W can be designed very easily. All we need to do is to make sure that when the agent really takes that optimal action, he gets enough things to cover his cost. Okay? This equation is to make sure that the agent's utility is non-negative for any Q. But actually, you know, Q is deterministic on A, so it doesn't really matter. Or write this in another way, is that the payment should be just the inverse function of U with respect to A star. Okay, so that if you plug in this into the utility function, you will get U of U inverse A star, which is A star. Okay, you can do this because the function is something you can control. Okay, so this is first best. And now it's second best. The principal cannot choose A directly. So the principal choose a function. With that function, the agent thinks about how to maximize his own expected profit for this format. Okay, I choose A. A decides Q. Q decides the payment. And the payment decides my utility. And I have the cost. Again, the principal need to make sure that the agent will stay and then maximize the principal's expected profit. So now, how may the principal induce the first best effort level? Well, we play the same trick. I know what should be A star. Then I know what should be Q star, the expected ideal outcome. Then again, all I need to do is to shoot the agent if the outcome is not good. If the outcome is good, pay you what you need. Otherwise, shoot you. Okay? So the output-based compensation plan is still efficient and optimal. So the two scenarios are either we have a risk-neutral agent or we have a risk-averse agent. Okay? So that's different. But the fact is that the output-based compensation plan can still be efficient. Because all we need to do is know. Okay, if it is first best, what we will do? And then control the first best scenario by setting that our compensation plan is something that if you do that, you're good. Otherwise, go die. Okay? This can happen simply because your compensation plan can be designed in that way, simply because the outcome is 100% predictable. So when the outcome is deterministic, delegation really does not create any problem. Okay? It doesn't really matter whether the agent is risk averse or not, because we can always implement the do it or I shoot you contract. The agent would get a payment that is just enough to cover his cost for taking the first best action. Otherwise, the agent would get a very large penalty, which the agent will try to avoid. Okay? So the agent in equilibrium earns nothing, which means there is no information rent. Even though there is a piece of hidden information, hidden action, it doesn't really help the agent. Okay? It doesn't really help the agent. The principal can always implement the first best with an output-based compensation plan. The principal doesn't need to really monitor the agent's action or effort, whatever, as long as the outcome is deterministic. Because if the outcome is deterministic, it can be used to accurately infer the agent's action. So that's how the principal can play this idea, right? So this motivates us to study the next model in which the outcome is somewhat random. As long as we all agree the outcome is random, then I just cannot shoot you if the outcome is something I don't like, because it's always possible that it is the nature that is playing the random thing. Okay, so that's the topic in the next video. Thank you. Okay, so let's study the binary outcome model in which the outcome is not going to be deterministic anymore. So there are all kinds of ways to model a random outcome. The easiest way is to say the outcome is binary, which means the outcome follows a Bernoulli distribution with two possibilities. So let's call them 0 and 1. Given the effort, which is A, I'm going to assume that the probability for a good outcome to be observed is P of A. Okay? So P of A, this probability function, is increasing and concave, and no greater than 1. So if the agent puts more effort, it's more likely for the outcome or for the project to be successful. But effort has diminishing marginal benefit. Okay, when you already put a lot of efforts, more effort would be not so useful. Okay, so we should still discuss four cases, right? Just like the previous video. The action may be observable or not. The agent may be risk neutral or risk averse. In each case, the principal should design a compensation plan, as what we did. Here are a few things. Because the outcome is binary, either 0 or 1, so if we are designing an output-based contract, then that contract would only contain two numbers. What I would pay when the outcome is bad, what I would pay if the outcome is good. Okay, because the outcome is binary. So if this is an output-based contract, then it's W0 and W1. When the action is observable, then we should ideally or we should technically be able to contingent the payment according to the effort level we observe. Okay, but as you can already feel, this is not needed. Because if we can really observe the action, then we're going to assign a work level to the agent. Okay, we will decide A, and once we do that, there is no need to specify a function. All we need to do is to specify the value of the payment when the effort is A. Okay, so it doesn't really matter. All we need to do is to work with two numbers, W0 and W1. We know that the shape U function has different shapes. Different shapes can decide the agent's risk attitudes. So that works directly with risk-averse agents. And once we have that, the risk-neutral agent can be studied as a special case with the assumption that U of W is just W. So we will study the more general case. And if you need a special case with risk-neutral agent, just do it. So if the action is observable, the principal's problem would be formulated in this way. What's this? I'm going to decide three numbers, the action level, and the two payments when the outcome is good and when the outcome is bad. With probability P of A, I will see a good outcome. In that case, I'm going to earn $1 because Q is 1. But I need to pay W1 to the agent. With probability 1 minus P of A, the outcome is bad. and then I earn nothing. I earn zero because Q is zero, but I still need to pay the agent W0. Okay, the agent can earn this amount of money when the outcome is good or when the outcome is bad, but that money goes into the utility function so that the agent gets the expected utility according to the earning, and then the agent need to pay the cost. Okay, so that's the format. The principal need to make sure that the agent can stay in the system by earning a non-negative utility. So the constraint again must be binding at an optimal solution. Okay, but now it's not really helpful because we just don't have something to plug in back to the objective function. So now if we really want to solve this problem, now it's time to use the KKT condition. Okay, we really need it to reduce the program. So let's think about what should we do. Here, we're going to associate a Lagrange multiplier to this constraint, right? And if you go back to the slides that when we were introducing the KKT condition, in that general case, we assumed the constraint is a less than or equal to constraint. In that case, your lambda would be non-positive. So here, because we have a greater than or equal to constraint, our lambda should be non-negative. Okay, so that's something we will use in the next slides when we show you the derivation. But here, let me highlight the outcome. Let me highlight the result. If I have an optimal plan that can solve the principal's first best problem, then I would have WE0 equals W1. Okay, I will pay the agent a fixed payment. I will pay the agent a fixed payment. No matter what happens, no matter what's the outcome, the agent will get the same thing. Why is that? Well, the agent is risk averse, while the principal is risk neutral, right? So the agent actually prefers a fixed payment rather than an uncertain payment. So if the expected values are the same, the agent prefers a fixed payment. If the agent prefers that, then giving what he wants would be more profitable to the principal, right? Because then in some sense, you don't really need to worry about whether he likes it or not. So the agent hates risk, but the principal does not care about risk. So the best thing is for the principal to take all the risk. So let's see how that can be proved in the next slide. Okay, so given any non-negative lambda, I first find the Lagrangian. So that should be the objective function plus lambda times those things in the constraint. Okay, those things in the constraint. And then I don't need too many steps. All I need to do is the first order condition with respect to W0, with respect to W1. I can see that if I differentiate the Lagrangian with respect to W0, I can get this. Or with respect to W1, I can get this. Now, this is just very basic differentiation. So let me just leave the outcome to you. Please verify them by yourself. And once you do some simplification, you get this. Your optimal W0 and W1 and the given lambda should satisfy the two equalities, okay, according to your first order condition. If W0 and W1 is optimal, then this must be satisfied. And that directly means W0 and W1 must be identical, right? Must be identical. You probably want to do one final check, is that W prime is positive. So this makes sense because the given lambda would also be non-negative, or in a sense that is really positive. Okay, so this equation can really be satisfied, and to satisfy them, we really need W0 to be equal to W1. If I want W0 and W1 to be optimal, this must be satisfied with no exception. Okay, so again, what's the intuition? I can control the effort, so I will decide what the agent should do. That's fine. And I want to compensate the agent the cost for doing that action. And what's the most efficient way to do that is to give the agent a fixed payment, because the agent simply hates risk. So all I need to do is to ask him to do something and pay him the cost. Very quickly, we're going to see that's not going to work if we are working with a risk-averse agent, and when the outcome is not, and when the input is not observable. So suppose the action is unobservable. Okay, now I cannot ask the agent to do something. I can only offer W1 and W0, and then for the agent to choose A to maximize his own expected utility. Now, A is a variable in this objective function. So an optimal A would satisfy the first order condition. Okay, so I differentiate this with respect to A. This goes to P prime of A, U plus minus and 1. So this is the first order condition with respect to A. The principal's problem would be this. Again, this is the IC constraint. This is the IR constraint. All I need to do is to say, okay, I cannot control A directly, but I know, given W1 and W0, A would be chosen so that the first order condition of the agent's problem would be satisfied. Then this is the principal's problem. I cannot control A directly, so I design my compensation plan W0 and W1 to induce an effort level. To solve this problem, in the next slide, we will show you how to use the KKT condition to solve that again. But the most interesting thing that we want to highlight is, if there is an optimal solution, it's going to satisfy W1 is greater than, strictly greater than W2. Why is that? Now, the agent does not like to work, right? The agent has no reason to work if the agent gets a fixed payment. If I give W1 equals W0, okay, think about the case that you are an agent. You get a fixed fee, no matter what's the outcome. Then there is really no reason for you to take any action. Okay, so now, because of the hidden action, the principal really need to offer something, offer a difference of W1 and W0, so that I can get some positive action. So I really need a bonus for a good outcome, a bonus for a good outcome. Okay, so that's proof that previous argument. So now we have two constraints, right? So I need two Lagrange multipliers. And technically, when you have an equality constraint, your Lagrange multiplier would be unrestricted in sign. Okay? If it's an inequality, then you have a sign constraint. But when it's an inequality, your mu for the second constraint would be free, can be positive, negative, or zero. Okay, so given Lagrange multipliers, the Lagrangian would be this one, the objective function, lambda times the first constraint plus mu times the second constraint. First order condition would directly give us blah 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 and blah blah blah. No. All you need to do is to do this calculation once, so that you can verify that they are the same. But basically, it's just a first order derivative with respect to W0 and W1. So please try to verify these two equations and tell me if they are wrong. Okay, but after that, we can do further simplification. That simplification is to make the conditions presented in this way. Okay, it's very interesting, because once you do this, you can make a direct comparison between these optimal conditions with the optimal conditions for the first best scenario. So first of all, if we look at these conditions, if mu is zero. Then this term goes away, this term goes away. The remaining thing is just the first best optimal condition. Okay? And we would set W0 to be W1. So that means the principal has the option of implement the first best outcome. Okay? If that's really what he wants. But actually it is not. Because the principal now has the chance to alter mu to improve her expected profit. Okay? The principal can set mu to be, the optimal mu for the principal to maximize his own expected profit may actually be positive or negative. Okay? No one says it must be zero. So, actually, we can show that the optimal contract satisfies mu greater than zero. Okay? When mu is greater than zero, the principal can really do the best. Okay? Can really do the best. If you have some free time, try to think about why mu must be positive for this to be an optimal solution. But when you take that as given, let's think about what's going to happen to mu at W1, W0. We know that u prime is decreasing because u is a function like this, right? So your u prime is the slopes. The slope would be decreasing. And given that, we know u prime, 1 over u prime would be increasing in W. Okay? So this is an increasing function. So that means if your right-hand side is larger, then the W would be larger. Then immediately, if we know mu is positive, then all the terms here are all positive numbers, right? So that means for this term, okay, it is lambda minus a positive thing. For this term, it's lambda plus a positive thing. So this is going to be greater than that. So your W1 would be greater than W0. Done. Okay? So with the optimal conditions, we can say, we can prove that W1 must be greater than W0 as long as mu is positive in an optimal solution. And it can really be shown that mu would be positive in an optimal solution. Then that's the end of the proof. So quick summaries. When the agent is risk averse and the outcome is random, then whether the effort is observable really makes a difference. When the effort is observable, then we don't really have the moral hazard problem. All we need to do is to set the two payments to be the same, to remove risks from the agent. That's the most important thing to do in this scenario. Okay? Because the agent does not like risk, so that's the principle. Take all the risk. Then the system would be efficient, and the principal can earn the most amount of money. But if the effort is unobservable, then now the one more important thing to do is to provide some incentives for the agent to work. Then we really need to set W1 to be greater than W0. Otherwise, the agent really have no reason to work. And then we would have no probability for the outcome to be successful. So here we can see information asymmetry or hidden actions actually results in a deviation or a distortion on the optimal contract, okay? And results in efficiency loss, which is the central theme of this course, right? Information asymmetry now really creates a problem. It can be shown that if the agent becomes risk neutral, okay, then the second best contract would also be efficient. So that means here, the derivation we did is that the agent is risk averse, and we show you that whether the effort is observable will give us a different contract. But if the agent is risk neutral, we can prove that the two scenarios will give you the single outcome, the same outcome. So that's something that I don't want to show in the videos directly, but it can be done. So collectively, we can say that risk aversion is really necessary for moral hazard problem. Okay? In this video, we are talking about a scenario with a random outcome. And then we say that either we need unobservability or we need risk aversion. If the agent is risk neutral or if the effort is observable, then we don't really have moral hazard problem. Okay, so yeah, think about it. Thank you. Okay, now is our last topic. We're going to introduce you the LEM model. Okay, so our objective is to have a model that studies the uncertainty of random outcome. But in the previous video, when we introduced the first model, that's the binary model. Your outcome may just be either 0 or 1. So here we want to somehow broaden our understanding and to study a random outcome that is continuous. Okay? So that's what that's our objective. But unfortunately, researchers have shown that if we consider a moral hazard problem with a general random outcome, then the problem can be easily intractable. We are unable to find any analytical solution, and then the study cannot proceed. So that means we need to somehow narrow down and consider some special types of distributions. So that's the LEM model, a tractable model with continuous outcome. In the LEM model, there are three components. First, the random outcome will be assumed to be following a normal distribution. And then, the utility function must also have a special format. In general, it's concave, but here we need to set it to be negative exponential. And finally, the compensation plan cannot be too weird. The compensation plan must be linear. So technically, the outcome Q will be assumed to be A plus epsilon. A is the action or the effort level, and the epsilon is a normal random noise whose mean is 0 and the variance is sigma squared. Okay, this is a normal distribution, and that means your expected value of Q will just be A, and there is some random noise. The agent's utility function will be set to be following this particular format. Okay, if you think about the functional form, first you have an exponential function, and then the exponent is multiplied by negative 1, and then we make the whole function multiplied by negative 1. So what does that mean? Suppose you have an exponential function like this. Then once you multiply the exponent by negative 1, you're going to get something like this. And finally, if you multiply the curve by negative 1, then you're going to get something like this. Okay? And then this is your u of z. So the x axis is z, and the y-axis is u. So you're probably wondering why the utility is negative, but that doesn't really matter. All you need to do is to, for example, add 1 to the function, okay? Then your utility can get to positive, and that doesn't matter at all. So we will adapt this functional form, and you will be aware that something you can do is to add some constants to it so that you can scale it up or down. Here, we have a coefficient called eta. Eta determines the shape of the function. Okay, so we say eta is the coefficient of absolute risk aversion. One thing we will say is that if eta is becoming larger, then the agent becomes more risk averse. Or if eta becomes zero, then actually this reduces back to a linear function. then when ADA is zero, that means this customer is risk neutral. Finally, the compensation plan is somewhat restricted. It must be in a form like T plus SQ, where T is the fixed payment and the S is the commission rate. So that means I cannot design a nonlinear compensation plan or a compensation plan that if outcome is this, that's good. If outcome is that, I shoot you. No, I cannot do that anymore. The compensation plan now must be linear. Okay, so now we have the model. Our task is to derive the optimal compensation plan and the equilibrium action. So let's try to do this. First, we need to analyze how the agent will choose his action. So given an offer, TS, the agent will choose action A to maximize his expected utility, which is this guy. Okay, Z is the random payment, depends on T plus SQ, that's the first part, and also 1 over 2 A squared. 1 over 2 A squared, I forgot to put it in the previous slide, this is the cost of exerting efforts. Okay, so that means I as an agent, if I put some effort, I can change my distribution of my random payment. But in any way, I need to pay a cost. I need to pay a cost. If we further derive the formula, then we can say this Q is random, right? And the Q is A plus epsilon. Because in all the things here, only epsilon is random. So we may simplify the expected utility to this one. So what we did is to decompose this exponential function to two pieces. This part is a constant, and only this part contains a random term, epsilon. And after we do that, we can take the constant outside the expectation. So we get this. Okay, this is just a constant, and our task would be to find what's this expected value. Okay, but the good thing of this model is that the expectation is actually a bilateral Laplace transform of this random normal random variable epsilon. Okay, or you don't really need to know what's this, but to get this expectation, there is a way. So in general, given any normal random variable and a constant, if we want to calculate this, then we would get this guy. Okay? So this expectation can be done. So this is a typo, this should be plus. Okay, this should be plus. Okay, so let's see how to do this magic. So I have my task. My task is to find the expected value of e to the power of r epsilon, where r is a constant and epsilon is a normal random variable. So I follow the formula of expectation. I have this function e of rx, and I need to do a weighted average of this guy with respect to the weights as the PDF of the normal random variable. Okay, this is the PDF of a normal random variable. Once we do that, we take this constant outside and combine these two exponential terms into this guy. And then we do some manipulations. For the numerator, we add r squared sigma to the power of 4 and minus r squared sigma to the power of 4. Once we do that, we can have a square for the first part and have the other term at the second part. And now we decompose the two parts again. The first part here goes to here, and the second part here is a separate term. Okay? Then all we need to do is to take this outside, because this term has nothing to do with x. X is only here. And once we take this outside, we also take that 1 over square root of 2 pi sigma. into the integral. And if we check this, this whole thing would just be the PDF of another normal distribution whose variance is still sigma square and whose mean is r sigma square. Okay, the mean is here. So if you check the PDF of normal random variable, you can verify, oh, this is true, oh, that is true. So that's good. And the best thing is that once this is a PDF of a normal random variable, then the whole term here would just be 1, because that's probability theory. Okay, then all you have is the remaining thing here. That's the end of the proof. So once we have this, the agent's expected utility can be further simplified. We have the one constant term outside the expectation, and the expectation gets to this if we replace r by negative eta s. Okay, so then we combine the two terms and get this one. Okay, not a surprising thing because we know how to do that. Finally, we define something called the certainty equivalent of the agent's utility function as the exponent. Okay, so we have the exponent. We define the exponent as a certainty equivalent as a function of the action. Okay, what's this? This is something that people use to measure, to combine the expected return and risk of a random outcome. We have two terms. First is this guy. What's this? This is exactly the expected return by exerting effort A. Okay, by exerting effort A, we get this random return. But interesting is that this one, on the second term here, measures the risk due to the uncertainty. I, as an agent, I don't like risk, so I have eta. When eta becomes higher, I do not like risk anymore. I also have risk coming from two things. First is the commission rate. If I have a commission rate, then that means my payment is given by the outcome. Okay, the sales outcome will determine my payment, which is risky. Or if the random variable itself is more dispersed, then there is more risk. So I can combine the three risks and get a measurement in this way, okay, in this closed form. So certainty equivalent really combines the expected return and the risk, okay? And that means this is a fair representation of the agent's utility function. Okay, if we have this, that's great. Why? Because the agent's expected utility is this. The agent should try to find A to maximize this function, which just means to maximize the certainty equivalent, because the exponential function is monotone and increasing. So once we know this, then all we need to do is to find A to solve this. Obviously, the answer would just be small s. And what does that mean? This is very intuitive, because that means if the principal increase the commission rate s, that's going to increase the effort level of the agent. A higher commission rate can induce the effort level. Okay, and in one extreme case, if s is 0, then the agent will not do anything. If s is 0, then a would just be 0. Okay, so now it's time to study the agent, the principal's contract design problem. The agent, the principal's expected profit is this one. The random profit is 1 minus s times q minus t. Q is the random outcome. 1 minus s is the share to the principal. T is the fixed payment. Okay? In equilibrium, we will have q equals a plus epsilon, which is just s plus epsilon. Because in equilibrium, the equilibrium effort level would just be s. That's why we get this. Okay? we decompose Q into S and epsilon, and the expected of epsilon is just zero. Then we get this as the principal's expected profit. The trade-off is very clear. If I increase the commission rate, then the effort would become higher, but the share that can be retained by the principal would be smaller. The agent certainty equivalent in equilibrium will be CE of S, because again, the action would just be S. So if we plug in S into A, we get this, which is in this format. Finally, the principal's problem can be formulated as choose T and S to maximize its own expected profit, subject to that the agent certainty equivalent must be non-negative. So here, we consider the certainty equivalent instead of the utility function. But you know, it doesn't really matter because you can always scale each other. If this thing is non-negative, that means the negative exponential utility function is above a certain level. If you actually need the utility to be above, for example, zero, then this would become another constant. But as long as the right-hand side is a constant, it doesn't really matter. Okay, so obviously the constraint must be binding at any optimal solution. So the principal's problem can be reduced to this one. Well, you can see there is a typo. There should not be this term S, a T. Okay, so now we want to choose S to solve this obviously concave function. The first order condition gives us the optimal commission rate in this format. Okay, so that's the analytical solution of this principal agent problem. Now it's time to give some economic interpretations to this final outcome, the optimal or the equilibrium commission rate. So first, we can see this is positive, good. And second, this is less than 1, also good, because it doesn't really make sense if the commission rate is above 1. And then, S is determined by eta and the sigma squared. S actually decreases in eta. That means when the agent becomes more risk-averse with a higher eta, then the agent would prefer a lower commission rate, okay? Because if I am really risk averse, then I would highly prefer a fixed payment. Then the principal will cut down my commission rate, and you may expect the eventual final system would become less efficient, because this guy don't want risk. So this guy don't want a high commission rate, then this guy will not work. And that's also reasonable, because if you exert efforts, your outcome, your benefit is random, but in any case, your cost is deterministic. So if you are really risk averse, you would not do this. You actually will not do a salesperson, you probably will do another job. At the same time, S star decreases in sigma square. Okay, decreases in sigma square. That means when the outcome becomes more unpredictable, when the random noise becomes even more noisy, then the agent would also prefer a lower commission rate. Because I am risk averse, then if the outcome is more unpredictable, I would really hate commission rate, because that gives me a lot of risk. Then I would again prefer a higher fixed payment. Okay, so that's something showing that this commission rate or this compensation plan makes sense. Okay, and very quickly you can see if the agent is risk neutral, eta would become zero. Okay, eta would become zero. And if that happens, S would become one. Or if sigma square is 0, then also S would become 1. What does that mean? That means the problem goes back to the first best. That means the problem is not a problem. If the agent is risk neutral, then random noise doesn't mean anything. because the agent just don't care about risk. If there is no randomness, then risk aversion is not a problem because the payment would just be deterministic. Okay, so that directly confirms our intuition that risk aversion and randomness are required if we want the moral hazard problem to show up. There's one final note. We are dealing with a linear contract. That's why we get this compensation plan. But in general, no one says your contract must be linear. Okay? So no one says this optimal commission rate is really optimal to the principal. Because if the principal wants, the principal can actually design a much more complicated contract to see if that is possible to make his profit even higher. Okay, that's possible, but that's beyond the scope of this course and beyond most of the scope of the analysis because it's in general intractable. Okay, so that's why LEM model is still useful even though it is suboptimal, but it's tractable and linear contract is widely accepted in practice. Okay, now it's time to give a quick summary. Hidden actions creates the moral hazard problem. Okay, because the action is hidden and costly, the agent must be incentivized or compensated for his action. Compensation may or may not be inefficient. Okay, so I delegate a job to the sales agent or to the agent. I need to compensate him. Sometimes the compensation can be designed so that I can recover the first best outcome. Sometimes I cannot. And the factors that determining whether the outcome can be efficient are here. Okay? Delegation is really a problem when all the following elements exist. The action is unobservable. The outcome is uncertain. And the agent is risk averse. If we have all of them, then we have moral hazard. Otherwise, delegation does not really create a problem. Okay, so that's for adverse moral hazard. Now this is the end of this whole series of lectures. So overall, we have studied screening, signaling, and moral hazard, right? Screening and signaling is under the categorization of adverse selection. And the moral hazard deals with hidden action is another thing. But altogether, they form the theory of information asymmetry. The whole thing of this series of lectures is that the world is decentralized, right? And the decentralization may bring in the incentive issue because you cannot control that guy. So you need to provide incentive for that guy to do something. And we have all kinds of ways to deal with the incentive problems, basically mechanism design or contract design. And information asymmetry would aggravate the issue, would make your contract design problem harder, okay? Because there is something you don't know. Then you really need to design a more complicated contract. And that's the whole thing of this series of lectures. Okay, I hope you enjoyed. Thank you.